The next document is the Advanced Healthcare Directive, which is the new terminology for a document that combines the functions of both the living will and power of attorney for healthcare. The Advanced Healthcare Directive is now the most up-to-date, comprehensive document for stating your healthcare wishes and empowering someone to interface with medical personnel and make decisions in case you are unable. Many tend to think about the Advanced Directive in terms of irreversible comas and end-of-life measures, overlooking what might be a more compelling reason for completing a directive, that is, empowering an advocate. Many of you with experience in medical matters already understand the importance of having partners, advocates, and helpers in your medical care. Story after story can be told about how often it has made the difference between life and death, suffering and recovery, and catching fatal mistakes, inconsistencies, or problems that would have gone unnoticed. Given circumstances of being sick, physically impaired, or facing surgeries, how many of you, going it alone, could properly process, evaluate, track, and pay attention to everything that is being done to you or thrown at you in the hospital or medical situations? Or conversely, how many of you would prefer having someone who can watch your back and assist under such circumstances? If you need more convincing, search the term iatrogenic deaths. There you can find conservative estimates of close to 1 million deaths a year caused by medical mistakes, adverse reactions, misdiagnoses, unnecessary interventions, and other hospital-related complications or miscommunications. This paints an all too familiar picture that many of you have seen from one side or the other and builds the case for how important and often even essential it can be to have someone besides yourself who can watch over and fully interact with the medical personnel on your behalf. The problem is, we live in an era of strict privacy laws, and without proper written authorization, you risk denying even your spouse or closest loved one the ability to provide input or receive any information in a medical situation or emergency. Without it, they may be unable to get answers, discuss your condition and treatment, or even help in the ways you may need or want. It doesn't matter if it is your parent, partner, best friend, sibling, or adult child, you could still be refused. Properly completed, however, an advanced directive generally gives you the power to overcome these barriers by simply signing the optional line that states you wish your agent's authority to start immediately. It should be emphasized that signing this line does not give your agent the power to override your wishes. The point of doing so is to free the hospital's doctors and other medical personnel to interact with your appointed agent. Put another way, it is to empower your agent to be your concurrent helper, advocate, and partner in your medical care. Otherwise, if you do not sign this line, your agent will often not be allowed to help, communicate, or participate unless you become fully incapacitated. On the other hand, if you don't want anyone to be able to help or participate unless you are incapacitated, or you are somehow worried about such things as your agent digging through your medical records or using their power for some nefarious purpose, then you should decline to sign this option. But then we have to ask, why would you be okay with that person deciding your fate if you were incapacitated? In truth, there is no end to how elaborate you can make an advance directive. You could literally spend many hours of attorney time discussing your options with detailed, lengthy, and custom drafting. That, however, is something that would take us way beyond the intended scope of this service and that of most living trust processes. More importantly, in our experience, the more expensive and involved you try to make a directive, the less likely it will get done, which means having no protection at all. That is why we have purposely chosen to include a directive that sticks to the basics of appointing agents and allowing you the option to currently empower them. It is simple, straightforward, and can be completed in a matter of minutes, and allows you to get something in place very quickly and easily. And you can always complete a more elaborate health directive at any time. We believe overcoming privacy barriers and giving someone the power to be your advocate and helper is one of the most powerful, primary, and perhaps most important capabilities and functions of an advanced directive. In terms of day-to-day use, this need for a directive comes up far more often than that of irreversible comas and other extremes. And even then, we believe no amount of written instructions can ever substitute for the better judgment of someone you trust. None of this is to say you have to follow our suggested strategy. You don't. Just know that it comes from the larger experience of seeing so many that never finish a directive, as well as from seeing many others caught without one when they really needed it. That is why, whether you use our approach or prefer a more detailed one, we strongly urge you to get something in place right away. If you choose to use our included directive, you begin with part one, where you should fill in the name of your chosen agent where indicated. You will also find spaces for optionally naming up to two other alternate agents if you would like. You should then move on to part two, where you have the option to affirm that your agent's authority is to start now. We've already gone over all the reasons why you should strongly consider this. By signing part two, you presently empower your agent to be your concurrent advocate and helper. If you do not sign part two, you will have to be fully incapacitated before they are allowed to participate. Part 3 allows you, if you'd like, to express some overall wishes regarding end-of-life care and life support. Though completing this section is entirely optional, many seem to want to express a preference that no extraordinary measures can be used that would needlessly prolong dying and suffering. If you would like to do so, then you will want to consider reading and signing option A. Remember, however, that you have already empowered your agent to make these kinds of calls, and by leaving this section blank, you are essentially saying you would rather leave it up to your agent's best judgment, an approach that many prefer. Once you are through section 3, you should sign and date your directive where indicated in part 4. Now, all you have to do is have the directive witnessed or notarized for it to become legally enforceable. And you should do so right away. For many reasons, we believe notarizing is best, especially since many directives are improperly witnessed. If you have it notarized, be sure that the notary properly signs, stamps, and completes the notary area in Part 5. If you have it witnessed, be sure to very carefully follow the instructions and procedures detailed in Part 6.